Switzerland. For many, the first thing that comes to mind after hearing that name is simply neutrality. The small European nation has a widely known reputation for everlasting impartiality when it comes to global warfare. But why is Switzerland always neutral? And what does that neutrality really mean? This video is brought to you by Call of War, the free online PvP strategy game played by millions of users worldwide. In this game, you can join the war with the country of your choice and fight other players in epic real-time battles. Conquer the world in very challenging games that can take over several weeks with up to 100 real players per map. Start in historical World War II environments and rewrite history as you want. Rush your opponents, establish air superiority, and bombard coastal cities. As you grow during the game, you can invest in the research tree to use atomic bombs and other new technologies from World War II. In battle, use the strength and weaknesses of different unit types such as ships, planes, or tanks. Build your empire by conquering provinces, capture capitals, and take over entire countries. Win by forming strategic alliances and waging wars against your neighbors with other players from around the world. Call of War is a fully cross-platform game, so you can play from the same account on PC or mobile. We have set up a special game of Call of War for the first viewers that click the link in the description. Click the link below and enter the game name Nalogia and my password Nalogia. The slots are limited, so hurry up. Click our link in the description to get 13,000 gold and 1 month of High Command subscription for free. It has been centuries since the Swiss engaged in an international conflict. In 1515, the Swiss Confederacy was routed by the French at the Battle of Marignano, which prompted a new aim of self-preservation for Switzerland. From then on, the country maintained its neutrality indefinitely. Though one hiccup occurred during the Napoleonic Wars, when Napoleon Bonaparte's France invaded Switzerland and turned it into a satellite of the empire, the major powers of Europe still recognized Switzerland's neutrality and saw it as a valuable asset to the region. An impartial Switzerland would create a valuable buffer between opposing France and Austria and would promote some level of stability for the surrounding area. At the Congress of Vienna in 1815, a declaration was officially signed and Swiss perpetual neutrality became a solidified accord. World War I became the first major challenge to this unbiased stance. While Switzerland remained neutral in the First World War, it did still opt to mobilize an army in order to defend itself if needed. This worked in terms of keeping the nation out of conflict while still protecting its own borders, but it did create a new issue in the form of economic disputes. In order to mobilize their army, the Swiss sent much of their working-class men to guard the country's borders and gave no financial compensation for their wages lost during the time that they were stationed. Conversely, other citizens actually benefited from the war through higher demands on the chemical, timber, watchmaking, and farming industries, particularly those industries that provided goods to both sides of the conflict. In another contradiction, though, the government chose to finance defense efforts by the issuance of currency, which led to inflation. This uneven distribution of consequences caused rising tensions within Switzerland's own borders, leading to a strike at the end of 1918. The strike began in Zurich and stirred up fears of a Bolshevik-style revolution within the government, prompting them to swiftly send in their most loyal troops to either arrest or obtain a surrender from the strike leaders. The troops were successful after only 3 days, but due to the timing of the strikes, which coincided with the global Spanish influenza pandemic, many lives were subsequently lost, and resentment towards the working class became a long-lasting repercussion. On top of this complication during World War I, Switzerland was actually almost invaded by Germany. As if their internal struggles were not enough, the Germans strongly considered stirring up more drama trauma for the Swiss by invading the nation on their way to outflank the French. Germany was very nearly willing to completely ignore the blatant neutrality of their neighbor and only recoiled after Helmuth von Moltke the Younger, who executed the Schlieffen Plan being considered, decided that Belgium would serve as a better route than Switzerland due to the inferior state of the Belgian armed forces. Still, the Swiss stationed a vast number of their troops along the French border as an extra precaution in case the strife between the Central Power Germans and Triple Entente French were to reach Swiss territory. During this time, many German-speaking people of Switzerland predictably leaned in favor of the Central Powers. Meanwhile, the French-speaking preferred the Triple Entente. Although this made no difference in the official stance of neutrality, it did create some strain between the differing people. Switzerland also became a safe haven for a plethora of foreign refugees during the First World War, especially as its impartiality became more and more solidified. Following World War I, Switzerland became a member of the League of Nations in 1920, and Geneva became the newly formed organization's headquarters. In 1934, the Swiss Banking Act was passed, which opened up opportunities for Germans, including the Jews, who wished to hide their assets from the Third Reich to do so. By the latter half of the 1930s, the Swiss were fully anticipating another world war and began to prepare their army yet again. By 1937, the government started to recommend that all citizens maintain at least a 2-month supply of all basic necessities, and the following year, Switzerland withdrew from the League of Nations in order to take a complete stance of unbiased neutrality. The country also put a large focus on promoting its independent culture and identity to strongly distance itself from its neighboring belligerents. As war finally broke out once again, Switzerland made a clear threat to the surrounding nations: invade us, and we will retaliate. To back up their threat, the Swiss fully mobilized their army in a matter of 3 days. Possibly displaying more of a potential consequence than gain, Germany's chancellor, who had already referred to Switzerland as a pimple on the face of Europe, decided to heed its warning and abandon an invasion plan. Another likely reason for the Germans' respect of Swiss neutrality this time may have been the beneficial trade relationship between the adjacent nations. This factor may have kept Switzerland safe from the Third Reich, but it evoked thoughts of controversy from other countries during and after the war. Nonetheless, by 1940, as Germany occupied France, the Swiss were essentially surrounded by Axis powers and would likely have been unable to maintain safe neutrality without bending some rules. It is also important to note that Switzerland served as an espionage camp for both the Allied and Axis powers throughout the war, and was not only giving favor to Germany. Switzerland also became home to refugees once again, but this time, they were not as open. Afraid of potentially triggering the Germans to turn against them after all, the Swiss tightened border policies and began to charge taxes for Jewish refugees who entered the country, while others were simply denied entry. At one point, a Swiss government officially stated plainly, "Our little lifeboat is full." Yet again controversial though, Switzerland had actually attempted to shoot down roughly a dozen Luftwaffe aircraft back in 1940, which clearly demonstrated less of a fear of German retaliation than showed during border decisions. Though the Germans had invaded Switzerland's airspace over 190 times, which is what prompted the Swiss aggression, it still proved contradictory on the part of Switzerland, especially given that they ignored warnings from the German chancellor, who demanded that the neutral country cease its interference with his military. Even so, the Swiss were not singling out the Germans who violated their airspace. Multiple American and British aircraft were also shot down for the same reason, and the Allies actually faced casualties from those events. A representative from the US later in 1944 claimed that they had accidentally invaded Swiss airspace due to navigational errors, and insisted that a similar mistake had been made when they bombed the Swiss town of Schaffhausen in April of the same year. Somehow, Even such a ghastly violation as the Allied bombing was unable to shake Switzerland's neutral stance. With all the possible rationale to declare war or choose one side or the other, why did the Swiss refuse? Being a minuscule country situated tightly between France, Italy, Austria, and Germany, choosing either the Axis or Allies could have posed a major threat to the nation. While the Swiss army was not poor, it was still not to the standards of those from the larger warring powers, especially a combination of those powers. However, Switzerland's decision to declare armed neutrality, which allowed it to quickly and fully mobilize its army as a border protection measure, made it clear that a true phobia of conflict was not the issue. Rather, the Swiss simply wanted to utilize a strategy of self-preservation. As stated before, the position of the country geographically and its choice to be impartial in global conflicts also proved agreeable for the major European powers of the region. Switzerland provided them a buffer zone, a potential trade partner, and a safe place for refugees to flee to. It is possible that the approval at the Congress of Vienna and from the League of Nations had a hand in why the Swiss were unmovable when it came to their neutrality. But ultimately, nothing proved more important than preserving their own nation's safety and success. Even after the end of the Second World War, Switzerland refused to become a biased country. Although the Swiss had become more involved with international humanitarian efforts, they still maintained their impartial military stance and have refrained from ever joining the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, more commonly known as NATO, or the European Union. Switzerland did join the United Nations, or UN, in 2002, and has continued to maintain its army. But that is roughly the extent of its global and military engagements. So even today, after centuries of unbiased participation in the world, self-preservation stands as the Swiss's top priority and continues to be the root of why Switzerland remained fiercely neutral in World War II and any other global disputes. This episode was brought to you by Call of War. Conquer the world in challenging games over several weeks with up to 100 real players per map. Start in historical World War II environments and rewrite history. The game is fully cross-platform, so you can play with the same account on PC or mobile. Click our link in the description below to get 13,000 gold and 1 month of High Command subscription free, only available for 30 days.